This is Ham Radio Now from the Orlando HamCation. Another unnumbered episode so far. You see a number, you know, on the screen down there. I just don't know what it is right now. We're in the RV zone, or at least next to the RV zone here at the Orlando HamCation. RVing is a big part of this HamFest. You know, it's Florida, and it's wintertime, and so this is where folks with RVs, either traveling, but a lot of the folks that live full-time in their RVs tend to concentrate in terms of ham radio. It's got a lot of space here for them. And I've always thought this would be an interesting story. I know some folks that are deep into RVing, some folks that have been doing full-time RVing for over 5 years, and some other folks that are just getting started in it. And I thought this would be an interesting story for you, the Ham Radio Now audience, to learn more about RVing itself, because it's got that, you know, romance of the highway aspect to it, and how it ties in with ham radio. They do seem like they mesh pretty well together. So I talked to Herb and Lois in there, and before I talked to them, I walked around the RV zone and looked at a lot of the configurations that people have. Typical of ham radio, there's a lot of different ways to do things, and everybody seems to do things differently. So let's go wander around a little bit, and then let's go talk to Herb and Lois and find out all about RVing and ham radio.
All right, this is KL7IEK, and this is the HamCation version of the RV service net on 2 meters. And let's go to KK4, Alpha Golf, November. Go right ahead, number 14.
I don't know how well this is going to show up, because wire antennas typically don't show up very well, but right up there is the beginning of a long wire that heads out that way onto that pole. This is the other end of that long wire. I needed to see if it was a natural terrain feature, but no, it's been added. Just a little VHF whip on the back of that ladder. Between the two of them, they got quite an antenna farm. And here we've got 4 RVs and 4 different antenna configurations for HF. So if you can't decide vertical or horizontal,
okay, I'm standing on the walkway.
Do both.
Ditch.
Looks like a couple of more Eagle ones. I'm almost surprised that I don't see more screwdriver antennas on these RVs, since they work so well and are so easy. And this one has the, I think, motorized or maybe just manual tilt over, making it even easier. But getting the ground plane for a screwdriver antenna can be a little bit tricky. They have some specific things they want to see that might be a little difficult way up on top of an RV. On the other hand, the RV's got a big surface area. This is an official part of the show. We have a visitor. I forgot to put out the interview in progress.
Hopefully that'll be, I should put do not disturb.
Yeah, well, how often does that happen?
No, it should be it.
Okay, so that means that the show has already started. We're on the air. This is official. This is on the record. Who are you guys?
I'm Lois Maas, KA0VBG, and we are full-time RVers. We use Sioux Falls, South Dakota as a mailing address.
Who's this ugly guy next to you?
This is my husband, Herb.
I'm Herb Maas. My call sign is W0HM, and we've been married for a little over 40 years, and we retired, bought our motorhome, did some traveling, and enjoyed it so much we decided to sell our house and continue traveling full-time.
Okay, so as usual, you're going to get ahead of the story on me. I can never direct these stories. Coming down here to Orlando for the past 4 or 5 years, I could not help but notice this huge RV area out here and full of hams. And I know some of the guys that are hams that are doing the RV thing, but it seems to be a really big deal, particularly here at Orlando. And so I thought I would do a show finding out what ham radio and RVing has in common. it seems like a really natural thing that goes together.
Yeah, it does.
If you're a ham.
it does, and we've found that in our traveling in an RV, we find many more ham operators than we do just in the general public. It is very popular amongst RVers.
Okay, so cool. We'll get into that a little bit. Now, there's no way that in an hour or so show, we can do the RV experience. We're not going to cover all of it, but I'd like to hit some of the highlights, both of what it's like to be in. This is a romance thing, right? It's people just get that wanderlust idea and think they want to do it. A lot of people out there think, yeah, I want to do that. At some point in your past, you thought, I want to do that. And unlike most of the people who think that, you did it.
That's true.
Well, clearly you did, because
yes.
We're sitting here.
Yes.
How'd that happen?
When we bought our motorhome 10 years ago, we had never heard of full-timing. We did not even know it existed. And as we started to, we had a home in Minnesota, and we'd come to Florida to get out of the snow for a couple of months. And we started running into people that didn't have homes. And our first thought was, that's really strange. They don't have a home. And
that's sort of the definition of full-timing.
Yes. I
mean, that's pack everything up, sell the home.
Yes.
This is your home.
This is our home. Yes. We own no property, no home. We have everything right here. And we
do have a rental unit, 7x10 in Sioux Falls, South Dakota.
7x10 feet?
Yes.
So you have a big one. Compared to what I've heard from some people.
Some people, yeah.
Some people have a mailbox somewhere.
We have some furniture that Herb's dad made from scratch, so we wanted to keep it like a grandfather clock.
So it's a storage locker.
Yeah, it's a storage locker in a climate-controlled setting.
And about 10 boxes of old photographs from our whole lifetime that, you know, you have to put someplace.
Yeah. So the storage is an issue, I guess. And maybe we'll get around to that. But I was thinking of with this idea of full-timing. Now it goes from romantic to scary.
Well, it is a little at first, as we ran into people in our traveling when we still had a home that were full-timing. At first, we just thought it was an unusual situation, and we started to realize how many people were doing it. And I've seen estimates of that in, you know, how many people in the United States are full-timing, and it's a large number. It's hard to measure because nobody knows for sure. But we know it's large because there are mailing services all over the United States that are basically geared to help full-timers get their mail, and we use one of those. But originally, Lois said, I think I could do that. And I said, it seems a little strange to sell your house and everything you own. But as I thought about it for a little longer and we started talking about it, it sounded better and better all the time. And so we went ahead and did it.
So was the interest even between the two, or was one of you sort of driving it? Sounds like, Lois, you might have been actually pushing the idea a little bit harder.
Maybe, but no, I didn't really push it. I just thought I could do it, because there are some people that try it for a year and find out that one of the partners or spouses doesn't enjoy it, so they stop. And I wanted to say, too, we're meeting these people at campgrounds or RV rallies or hamfests that are full-timing it.
Yeah, not just ham radio, but there's a big community. Yeah, I want to talk about the community
in
a little bit.
Yeah, but they're not all full-timers either that go to these RV rallies, but you meet a lot of them, and then they'll have seminars on full-timing it.
Yeah, so I'm going to keep developing the story. So you guys got this RV 10 years ago, or a RV 10 years ago, but you didn't start full-timing right away.
No.
It was just a vacation thing?
Correct, exactly.
Correct.
How long would you take off and go play around the country?
2 or 3 months at a time.
So it was substantial.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And you had to bring everything that you needed to sustain yourselves. I mean, yes, there's still grocery stores everywhere.
Right.
Yes.
Right.
You know,
right.
You don't have everything all packed up.
Right.
You're not a hermit, but you're not. You don't have ties back to the stuff at home for those 3 months.
True.
Right.
Is that what convinced you could do it full time? That you could go that long? Or how do you go from vacation to life?
Well, at the point where we first started talking about it, I said it seems to make more sense to look at it as a vacation and then go back home and start planning your next vacation again. Well, at some point, when you make this decision, you know you're not going to go back home again ever. And so it's a big decision, and, you know, you've got 40 years of accumulated items in your house packed away in every closet and corner and drawer, and that you have to decide what to do with. And so it was a gradual process that we, the acceptance of it was a gradual process over probably a period of a couple of years before we actually made the decision to do it. And then we put our house for sale in a market that was not conducive to selling a house. So that took us about almost 2 years to sell our house.
And did you stay living in the house while you were working on selling it, or did you just kind of close it up and get on the road?
We did both. We would go back there for a while, and we would continue to travel. You know, it was probably a 50-50 thing at that point in time. And the final thing that put us on the road was a buyer for our house, and we drove away.
How did that typical media question, how did that make you feel?
Scary. And the one thing
I said romantic and scary.
Yeah. The one thing that I really miss is having Christmas in my own house. We have two daughters. One is in Oregon and one in Minnesota. So it was kind of scary, but I'm getting used to not having Christmas now in my house. I don't know. I think usually we have Christmas like at our daughter's in Portland, Oregon, or I have a brother in Phoenix that we've been at his home for Christmas. So if we're ever in a campground, we'll just enjoy Christmas with our neighbors.
There's probably a lot of things that went from strange to some version of normal for you that for everybody else is still going to seem strange. I mean, holidays are one of those things.
But we probably spend more time with our family, because we have family scattered around different parts of the country. We actually probably spend more time with family with our lifestyle than if we, you know, like a lot of people do very little traveling. They live in one place and they stay there most of the time. And so our traveling actually allows us to visit our family in many cases.
Yeah, you show up and stay for a while.
Yes.
But not in their house.
Right. We have our own bed, our own bathroom.
Good for you and probably good for them.
Yes.
So how did you downsize? You said you have a little storage locker that has the stuff that absolutely can't go with you but can't go away.
Well,
but
I guess...
But how did you make the big decisions on, you know, what a lot of stuff you didn't keep?
Right, and you just do it gradually. When our house went on the market, I started to go through everything. And you just, it's kind of a good way to clean house, really. You're getting rid of things you've had accumulated for years, and you find out that you don't have that hold on those things, and you just decide what things you really need, what things you can give away to your relatives. We did a lot of that, too. And then we finally had a garage sale when we found out our house was sold. But I think if I had to do it over again, I would be giving a lot of the items, furniture items, to charities. And then you can write it off on your income tax.
Okay, so instead of the hassle of selling it, finding a buyer, all that stuff, any charity is going to be happy to accept it.
Right. You just got to do a lot of calling, and I'm finding out some charities would take some items because a lot of items wouldn't sell at a garage sale, like a big TV set. And that took a little getting rid of, but we finally found a garbage company. Oh, no, I'm sorry. It wasn't a garbage company. It was a company that picks up stuff, and you have to pay them. But I was so glad because it was a heavy TV set to get rid of. That was the largest item to get rid of.
Anything that you guys got rid of that now you say you wish you still had?
No, it's actually the opposite.
More to get rid of?
We not that we kept a lot. We have this small storage unit, but we go back once a year, and we open the door and look at it. And we might add a few items or take a few items out of it. But in a lot of cases, we wonder, you know, maybe we should have gotten rid of more things.
Right.
So after 5 years, this is very comfortable.
Yes.
Yes.
This is the way life is.
This is home.
There are a lot of it. You know, while there are disadvantages in this type of lifestyle, like maybe not sitting in your living room by your Christmas tree at Christmas time, there are a lot of advantages, too. You don't have the home maintenance, you don't have the yard work, we don't have to worry when we do travel about somebody watching our home or somebody breaking into our home or the roof caving in because it's got 6 feet of snow on it or the furnace quitting and the pipes freezing. That freedom is probably the best part of full-time RVing. The the fact that there are a lot of things you don't have to worry about and you don't have to deal with, freeing you to do what you want in your life, pursue your hobbies like ham radio. Lois does a lot of sewing and quilt making. We have friends all over the United States that we've met through RVing that we now have the time to visit them and come to things like the Orlando HamFest, and that we wouldn't have probably had time to do with the home.
Yeah, I guess needless to say, you're retired, or at least, you know, not working full-time anymore.
We're both retired.
But people can work, you know, from the road, I suppose. Some people do.
Many do.
And we're finding young couples that are bringing their kids with them on the road and, teaching them, you know, in the motorhome, homeschooling their kids. So we run into all sorts of families on the road in campgrounds.
Yeah, I mean, with the internet and for folks that can do stuff, do their job on a computer and a phone.
Yes. Right.
You know, why be tied down?
Right.
So as you were figuring this out, and because we can't do a show that teaches everybody everything about this, there are resources out there, probably an overwhelming number of resources to help you figure it out. Did you take advantage of those, or did you just sort of wing it yourself?
We took advantage. The internet is wonderful for, you know, for researching anything, and anybody interested in full-timing RVing, if they're just interested in reading about it or actually doing it, you know, all you have to do is type in full-time RVing in a search engine, and you can read for days, weeks, if not months. And there's just a wealth of information out there that'll tell you, you know, how to do it, what to do, what not to do. There's seminars that we belong to, a club called Escapees, which specializes in full-time RVers, and they have a mailing service, and they help people establish new residency in a particular state that they may want to establish it in, and they'll help you with legal issues, and they have campgrounds all over the country that you can stay at a very nice reduced rate. And so the Escapees organization is a great resource, and they have a website. But there's just endless information out there.
And they have forms, too. You can type in full-timing RVing right on their website, and there's forms, and people will give their comments on full-timing, on motorhomes, how to buy your first RV, issues with motorhomes.
There aren't any issues, are there?
there are a few. But if something goes wrong, too, it's cool to have a Wi-Fi with you so you can do a search for your particular problem. And you sometimes find an answer, or you call the original manufacturer.
Yeah, I'll try to remember to talk about that internet thing in a little bit here.
Yeah.
I had a question and it just sort of faded away. That'll happen to me now and then. So when you were looking at these resources and deciding what to do, would doing the thing that you did, which is a long extended trip and then back home, is that a better way to break in? Because I've known some folks that just first time they spent very much time in it, they had committed to selling their condo and they were off to go full time. They knew that's what they wanted to do.
Sure.
But would you recommend to test drive?
I wouldn't recommend. It's probably one of the biggest steps most people take in their life. You know, after maybe getting married and having children, whatever, it's a big change, and it's not one. If you sell your house, you could just start traveling right away. But I don't know that I would recommend anybody selling a house that they had lived at long term in a neighborhood they had lived at long term, because if you do that, you can't ever go back. You know, we knew we didn't want to go back, but there are people that might, you know, I don't think there'd be too many, because most people we've talked to that are full-timers really enjoy it, and we've known, in fact, we've talked to a couple that did keep their home in full-time for a year or two, and at that point they went back and decided to live in their house for a while, and you'd hear stories like, we just sat and looked out the window at the RV, wishing we were back on the road, so we did go back on the road.
So you found some people that they tried it, it wasn't for them. Some people that tried it, not quite so sure, went back and then discovered, it was for them. Mm-hmm. But you have to try a little bit.
And I think the same thing applies in purchasing an RV. There's quite a few people that they may, you know, the typical story is they retire, they decide to buy an RV and they're going to do some traveling. Not necessarily full-timing, but they buy an RV, they do some traveling, and it's not what they thought it was going to be. They sell the RV a year later, and, you know, take a $20,000 loss on it. And if they would have researched it more, they might not have, you know, had to take that hit. So I think, like any big thing you do in life, you want to think it through very carefully.
Yeah, buying the RV, that's probably the biggest part of the research.
Yes.
That you're going to do. And there's lots of, again, lots of help out there. And we can't get very much into that, except that there's a fundamental question on which way to go. Some RVs are self-contained. The one we're in, right behind me, you know, the driver's seat and steering wheel and the engine's in here and all. And some are tow vehicles, fifth wheels, I guess, often called.
Yes.
You get a substantial tow vehicle, and then you can disconnect it. That may be the number one first question someone's got to figure out once they decide they're going to do this.
Yeah, and there is no right or wrong answer to that question. It's
except that of the limited survey of people that I know, mm-hmm. all started out towing, all ended up with a self-contained unit. What have I got the terminology right? What do we call it?
Yes, I'd be right.
Yeah.
You're right. More people seem to progress from, I guess, what I would call a trailer of some type with a tow truck or whatever. They seem to progress from that into a self-contained, like a motorhome unit. There are a few people that go the other way, and there are
some people
that start with one and always keep that. But you're right, most people that progress from one to the other end up in the motorhome eventually. Yeah. At least that's what we've seen.
And I guess the thinking is, well, if I tow, then I can disconnect and I've got a vehicle to drive around. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And if I'm self-contained, once you park it, what are you going to do? But almost everybody who does that tows a little car behind them.
That's true.
Yes.
Little car.
Yes.
Teeny
yes.
little car.
Yes. Yeah.
But something that you can then put her around town.
Yeah.
Right.
And from an economic standpoint, I think it depends on your lifestyle, but we put more miles a year on our car that we tow with us than we do on our motorhome, because when we go to a destination, we then use that tow car to go out and do all the sightseeing. And, you know, if we're at a national park, we might park our motorhome for a week someplace, and then we're in our car every day driving it. So, and getting fairly good fuel mileage, where if you're driving a 2-ton pickup that you're pulling a fifth wheel with, it's much more expensive to do your sightseeing in.
So do you always tow the tow car, or do you like to get in it, either of you, and you know, spin around behind somebody else driving the RV?
No, we always tow it. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Are there some people that, the couple that I know had I think they were towing a fifth wheel, and they had a car.
So that's true.
So that means they had to drive two vehicles all the time.
We have seen that, sure.
Sure, and we have seen a pickup, a fifth wheel, and towing a car behind that, a small car behind mm-hmm. that. Very seldom do you see that, but it can be done.
Yeah. How about scooters, motorcycles, or bicycles and things?
We use bicycles that we carry with us.
On the back of our tow car.
Yeah, some people do see quite a few motorcycles that people use as their getting around vehicle.
Yeah, but you got to be dedicated to that because weather is going to be a factor.
True.
Right.
So let's integrate ham radio into this a little bit. This is, after all, Ham Radio Now is the name of the show. So everything we talked about so far is pretty generic for just getting out there on the road and traveling. But how does ham radio work out for you in this lifestyle?
We've met a lot of, actually met in person a lot of people that we've made lifetime friends with through amateur radio. And the fun part about it is, as we travel, we are on the radio every day, basically, and we get to talk to the friends that we have all over the United States. And so that, you know, is a good part of it. I've been in amateur radio for about 30 years, and Lois almost that long. And I'm actually more active now on ham radio than when I had a home.
Now, last night there was a gathering. I guess they do this here in Orlando all the time. A lot of people sitting around a circle, prizes and stuff. And some of the people that I was talking to about that, it seemed like, at least for some seriously dedicated hams, when they went to look at an RV, the first question is, where can I put the radios and antennas?
That's true. And
it is a challenge
you know, compared to having a home with a yard. And
but they weren't looking at how big is the bedroom and you know, has the shower any good. It was like, okay, where can I put the radio stuff?
Yes, that's true. And people even look at the construction of the roof. You know, where can I bolt my antenna to, and how much metal is in the roof to establish a ground plane under my antenna? And so there's a lot of considerations in ham.
So I'm looking around here. I don't see a ham shack. Where's your radio stuff?
I'm sitting in the ham shack.
Okay. So. Okay, there, right up there.
My microphone is right here. My radio is up in the corner, and a lot of the internal larger parts of the radio are hidden away in a cabinet. But the part that I need to operate is just mounted to the wall right above our dinette, and so I can just sit here and operate. I can operate
an ICOM
7000 ICOM.
Okay.
And I can operate voice with my microphone. If I want to operate CW, I just set my key on the table here, and I have a plug-in down here where I can plug that in. And I do operate some digital modes. So I just set my laptop on the computer and run the cord down here and plug that in, and I have a modem that I can do that. So I can operate CW, sideband, 2 meters, 440, and digital modes, basically sitting at my dinette.
And we'll talk antennas in a little bit here. What else do I see up there? Okay, the radio control head, the speaker, and what's the other box?
That's a controller for the antenna to tune the HF antenna on the back of my motorhome. And I can tune it to run from 10 through 75 meters with that.
Okay. And the antenna that you have is, I looked at a lot of antennas out there. There's quite a variety. I wanted to be clever with this. And I was kidding some folks last night. There's one best antenna, right? And there's just one that everybody uses far and away better than any other possible antenna. Am I correct? Just like at home.
Probably not. It depends who you talk to.
Lois is going nuts here. This guy's getting himself in deep trouble.
As you walk around, the fairgrounds here are a good example with 100-plus RVs parked on it, most with multiple antennas. You don't see much consistency. Everybody has got figured out a different system. So it's interesting. Everybody finds a way to make it work, but they do it differently.
And your antenna system, tell me a little bit about that. What did you put together?
My antenna is fairly simple. It's because this particular motor home, the roof is almost entirely constructed of fiberglass. There's very little metal in it. I decided to use a dipole configuration. So I basically built a dipole using two motorized screwdriver antennas. And they operate together, and they tune simultaneously from 10 to 75 meters, so it's just basically a loaded dipole.
So I've seen that that configuration a little bit, but it's not something that I've seen tons and tons of. In fact, the guy that invented the Tar Heel screwdriver antenna, yours isn't a Tar Heel. Do you know what brand it is?
My brand is the Hi-Q. They're made by a company in California.
Okay, so I've seen the guy that invented the Tar Heel had one at Dayton. He was demonstrating up on a tower. First time I saw that, it makes a fairly expensive antenna because an individual screwdriver antenna is in the $300 to $500 range. So you need two of them for a dipole.
Yes, I got a bargain at the Dayton HamFest of some years back on these. The company was there in a booth selling them, and if you bought two of them, they promote the concept probably more than other screwdriver companies of running a dipole. They call their system tune a dipole, and they sell them in pairs. You can buy an individual one for, you know, typical installation on your car or pickup or motorhome, but they sell them as a match set pair, and they give you, at least at the time I bought them, a pretty substantial discount if you buy two of them. So I don't remember exactly. I bought the controller to tune those and the two antennas, and I think altogether it was maybe like $700.
Is the controller designed to control two antennas at once?
Yes,
Is there a problem keeping them in sync with where they're set? On some bands, especially the lower frequencies, it's pretty narrow, so you've got to keep them both aligned properly together.
No, there is a very easy procedure for doing that, and I've had no problems at all.
Cool. I'm thinking like the Step IRs. They make a dipole version of Step IR now, but I don't see any of those out here. Maybe it's too big.
Those are quite large, yes.
But it'd be also very convenient.
Yeah. Yeah, that would be probably be more for a home installation, but you could put one on an RV.
Yeah. Now, you can't drive down the road with that antenna in up and operating, right?
That's correct. You can put smaller antennas up, and some RVers do use those driving down the road. We regularly hear people checking into RV nets that they're driving down the road in their motorhome, but the the type of antenna you're going to do that with is going to be much smaller, and it's not going to work as well. So I've decided to go the route of put one up that works well, but we take it down when we travel.
So when you're actually on the road driving, you can't get on HF.
That's true.
Do you get on anything? Do you have a VHF, UHF?
Not when I'm driving. No, I figure it's probably safest to concentrate on when you're driving a motorhome with a car on, you're almost 60 feet long, and our motorhome is not that large, and some people are even longer, and you're in traffic, and I figure I probably don't need to be on a cell phone or on the radio or anything when I'm driving. So, no, I don't use the radio when I'm traveling.
Okay, so you're the safe one. He's the safe one. I talk to Lois. You get to talk to Lois.
Yes.
Or listen to radio.
Yes.
Podcasts and stuff. And I guess the issue is everybody wants their antennas up as high as they can get them, and you've got a vehicle that's nice and tall, but it's too tall. You put a screwdriver antenna pointing up from the roof of this, and it will last until the next highway overpass.
That's true.
And get scraped right off. So if you want one operating while you're driving, I guess it's got to be mounted low, and it's going to be shadowed by the vehicle body. And
exactly.
So.
Yeah.
So that's the guys that you do hear when they're operating mobile in motion are making that compromise.
Mm-hmm.
Who would have thought the world's best vehicle for planting an antenna on, and you can't use it while you're driving?
Well, we do know people that have both. They'll put an antenna, a high antenna, up in the campground, and they'll have another antenna they'll use when they're driving. So it just depends on, you know, how much time and money and effort you want to put into it.
Money is no object. So, really?
Yeah, really.
So that, I guess that speaks to a potential advantage to doing the trailer version. Because if you've got a tow car, then you can put an antenna on it. Although, I've seen some people had to squirrel around a little bit to be able to do that, because the trailer is back where you'd normally have your big screwdriver antenna. And so you can't put it back there. You got to put it up front someplace, which looks funny, but still works.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a matter of choices. There's a lot of choices out there, and you just have to decide what works,
yep,
you know, for you.
How much time do you spend actually moving versus being someplace?
Very little. We put about, this year has been probably an exceptional year. We don't usually travel as much because we went on a long caravan in the Maritime Provinces in Canada for most of the summer. But most years we travel about 12,000 miles a year. This year was more than that. But if you work out the math on that, it's probably 1% of the time, and the 99% of the time, you're parked.
Yeah, and it may be obvious, but I suppose we should say most people who do this, they travel in the summer and bed down somewhere warm in the winter.
Yeah, that's true. In the summer we head north, and in the winter we stay south, whether it be Arizona or Florida.
Yeah, if you think of from a weather standpoint, in the winter you're quite limited geographically to southern Texas, southern Arizona.
California, too.
Southern California and Florida, which is a very small part of the United States. In the summer months, you know, you are opened up to go anywhere, basically, so I think that's the typical pattern is people, they come to the southern states and they probably travel less because there's less warm places in the wintertime than there is in the summer. And then in the summer, you know, if you want to take a trip to Alaska or wherever, you know, you're free to go anywhere.
And what dictates not being in cold environments? Is it difficult to keep a home like this warm? Does it cost a lot of money?
It isn't so much the cost. They just aren't made for cold weather. They're not insulated like a conventional home. You have a lot of windows. You have thin walls. It's just they're not real comfortable if you start getting below freezing. Okay. You can do it, but it's just not, they're not, it's not practical.
And it's probably no fun to drive in a snowstorm.
No, that's very true.
So there's an infrastructure that is designed for you. Parks, campgrounds, concentrated in the south, places that are designed for you to come live.
Yes,
for
lots of them.
For the winter months.
Lots of them.
And across the same territory that you were talking about.
Mm-hmm.
How do you decide where to go? Where you've got all this freedom. How do you decide where to go during the summer, and how do you decide where to spend your winter?
Well, you make the reservations.
I make the reservations, but it all depends, too, on rallies, ham fests, relative reunions, if there's weddings, babies.
You're making this sound like it's practically painful.
No,
oh,
no,
my
no.
God, I don't know what I'm going to do or where I'm going to go. So many demands. You thought it was going to be total freedom, and you've got so many things to do.
No, and there are sometimes we travel and we don't have reservations. We like Corps of Engineer parks because they're usually by water. That's in the summertime.
Corps of Engineer. Is that open to anybody, or is this the Army Corps of Engineer?
Yeah, it is the Army Corps of Engineer.
I didn't know they had those things set up. I've got a friend who's military, and so he's got some parks he can stay at because he's got a military connection. Is that the same thing, or is it just one subset?
Well, with military, they get military discounts. With Army Corps of Engineer parks, if you're over 62, you get 50% off of your campgrounds. And depending on the, I call it the Corps park, you have full hookups, or you usually have water and electricity, and you're in a nice location. So we like to kind of find out where they are. There's a lot of them in Georgia and Alabama.
And you don't have to be military.
No. The Army Corps of Engineers. No,
cool.
It's open to anybody.
Never heard about them. So, in my typical wandering fashion of a Ham Radio Now interview, as you mention things, I think, oh, I want to ask about that, and I better ask before I move on. Hookups. You are semi-self-contained. I guess you can be totally self-contained for a while.
You are correct.
And power, water.
Yes, and we can get by on our batteries. We have batteries. We also have a generator that we can run to charge up the batteries. And if we want to run the microwave convection, we have to have the generator on. Some people travel with, what do you call them on the roof?
Solar panels.
Solar panels. We only have one, so we're limited.
And you drag a septic tank around with you.
That's correct.
Yeah.
We don't want to think about that, but you have to.
Yes.
That's a serious consideration.
Yes. And water, too.
Yes. And I've heard the term boondocking for being totally self-contained.
Yes. That's a whole facet of RVing that some people almost become possessed with.
That's all they do. They do not stay in campgrounds.
They learn how to live with, you know, very little, using very little water, and they have their roof covered with solar panels. That charges their batteries, that runs everything in their motorhome, and they can go out in the desert in Arizona at Quartzsite or whatever and camp free all winter and not have to hook up to anything.
Yep.
And it's kind of like ham radio. It's like, how far do you want to get into this hobby?
But for those folks whose idea of roughing it is a hotel room without room service, you can do better than that.
Yes.
You can have a little bit more luxury, and so they have that stuff around here. Do these campgrounds have hookup facilities? I didn't even look.
Yes, we have electricity and water here at this campground.
Okay, so you can, and I can imagine there's a variety. Some places will provide some things, and some places will provide more.
Exactly.
So power and water are the two big ones.
Yes, in most places that you stay, you do have that.
Yeah, and then to dump your tank, your leftovers,
right?
Mm-hmm.
Your waste tank. Probably not a hookup for that. Just someplace you stop by on your way out, or someplace to go.
Yeah, either you. Some campgrounds you have them at your site, right where your RV is, and some you have to stop
at a dump station.
Yeah, at a dump station on your way out. Yeah.
The fairgrounds here has a dump station.
Okay, and I imagine the places that are designed for you to stay long term over the course of a summer. Would have that in each individual site.
Yes.
So you don't have to go drive to the dump station.
How
long can you go either totally self-contained or without certain amenities?
We can go for probably a week easily without any kind of hookups if we want to. Some people longer.
All right. So where have you, in the 5 years you've been doing this, where have you spent the winter?
California, Arizona, Florida. Mm-hmm. That's about it also.
So the three places, I guess the Galveston Coast in Texas.
We haven't done that.
Yeah, but that would be another option. That's warm enough.
Right.
You get around Pensacola and Mobile, Alabama and stuff, that's still too chilly?
Yes. This time of year it can be very cold, below freezing, you know, way below freezing at night.
We usually like to be south of Tampa, Florida.
Yeah, people think Florida, all of Florida, is the sunny Southland, and the northern part, Jacksonville, Pensacola, that's still...
They have winter.
The leaves fall off the trees, they get snow now and then, gets below freezing. Mm-hmm. Does it get, like, really crowded? Do you have to plan well in advance where you're going to winter?
It all depends. If you want to stay in the state parks in Florida, you have to make your reservations 11 months ahead of time, especially the popular ones that are in the southern... or I should say south of Tampa. Even some of them in the middle of the state of Florida get hard to get into. During the week, you can usually get into some of these parks north of Tampa, but the weekends are already booked up by the locals. But there are private parks that you can get into. You might have to do some calling, but I think you could usually find one, especially in the Orlando area. Fort Myers.
Okay, and you guys are not living here at the HamFest grounds for the winter, but someplace in Florida?
Yes, all over.
You just pulled up. Okay, so you're moving around. You're not staying in just one place.
We have friends in quite a few different parts of the states. We have some friends near Tampa. We have some friends near Fort Myers. We have some RV friends that we stay with for a month south of Miami. So we will typically stay somewhere for maybe a month, and then we'll move somewhere for a few weeks, and then maybe someplace for another few weeks. So we cover most of the state over the winter time.
Some people stay, plant themselves in one spot until the winter's over.
And exactly, that's very common.
They can move on.
Yes,
but to each their own. Mm-hmm. However you want to do it. That's Where'd you go last summer?
We were on the Maritime Caravans.
That's right.
That was the end of June through...
That's the eastern part of Canada, right?
Yeah, right.
Nova Scotia, Newfoundland.
And even a little into Labrador. We did not take our motorhome into Labrador, but we got on a bus and took the ferry over to Labrador and just drove like 40 miles on the bus and then stayed overnight in a motel.
Motel's probably something you don't see very often.
Correct, right.
Because it costs money.
Yeah.
And you've already paid the money.
And plus, we already usually have our bed with us, but some cases it doesn't work out.
Yeah. So when you go up on a trip like that, on a caravan, how many people were involved?
Okay, there were 22 RVs, Winnebago. This was a Winnebago caravan. And some people were singles in their motorhome. These were all motorhomes. There were two single gals in each one of their own motorhomes. There was one guy by himself, and the rest were couples. So there was about 44 of us.
An organized event?
It was an organized event.
Is there by a company or some individual who said, I've got an idea, let's
put this
together?
Winnebago has their own what they call WIT Club, and they have a group of volunteers that... offer their services to direct you on these caravans, and then we have tail enders that are at the end of the caravan. And in the deal of a caravan, you're sent off usually in a group of four motorhomes, and one goes first, and then the second one sent maybe 5-10 minutes later. But the fun part is getting together.
So you
don't
try to line up on the highway.
That's right.
Tail to nose.
And the fun part is, you know, the get-togethers, and we discuss our travel plans. If we are traveling the next day and what the events for the next day are the night before.
Because it would seem like it would be fun to be going down the highway with 22 Winnebagos. By the way, Winnebagos are a real thing. It's not just a generic term for motorhome.
That's correct. It's a brand.
But it is sort of like a Kleenex of motorhomes, right?
Exactly, yes.
Everybody thinks Winnebago. And the other is Airstream.
Yes.
Which is, Airstream is that funny silver-looking thing. Yep. Looks like a can of Coors going down the highway.
That's right.
And it's Do they go away for a while and then come back? I mean, they're real popular now again, right?
They never did go away. We've never owned one. I'm not an expert on them, but...
There's one right back behind us there.
Yes, there's quite a few on the grounds
there. And one to the side of us.
They've always, to my knowledge, always been manufactured and always been around. And I think because Airstream is probably the only RV company that hasn't changed the appearance of their units, that people think that they're maybe not around anymore. I've seen people that aren't familiar with RVing that see an Airstream on the trailer, on the road, they see an Airstream trailer, and they think, you know, made those for 40 years.
They're 60 years old.
But that's not true. They've made them continuously.
Airstreams are all trailers, right?
No, they have made some motorhomes.
But mostly trailers.
Mostly trailers.
So that's the direction they're going to go. And you're saying the Winnebago has set up its own groups, and I imagine there's some independent groups that are Winnebago-based. Do people tend to gravitate toward other folks that have made the same brand decision?
It all depends. There are caravan groups out there that are not, like, brand-orientated. There's, like, a fantasy group that does caravans, and then whether you have a motorhome or a trailer, you can, you know, sign up for this particular caravan that you want to go on.
So was this the first one that you guys did, the one last summer, or had you done a few of those before?
No, this was our first caravan with Winnebago.
Did you like it?
Yes, it was a great time. It was on my bucket list.
And you said that they planned events each evening and tours. So did you move every day, or did you spend a few days in each spot?
It just depended what area we were in. Most of the time we'd stay 3 or 4 nights, and then there was lined up tours, whether it be a museum, just sightseeing, and we would get on a bus that Winnebago would rent from a bus company in whatever area we were in.
I'm exhausted. There's no rest. I thought this was just relaxing, and this doesn't seem to be any relaxing.
On a caravan, you're right. You are kept busy. There's usually one day a week you can do your own thing.
Yeah. My wife and I took a cruise as our honeymoon, Caribbean cruise. It was the same thing. They ran us ragged. I thought, you sit on the boat, you know, nothing's going on, you have a good time. Nah, tours every day, off on excursions to different island. So this can be that way, but I suppose if you decide you just want to park somewhere and put the awning outside and the deck chairs and put your feet up for the day, you can do that.
And we do that too.
Yeah, and even on the caravans, I must mention you did not have to participate in the tours every day. So it was an individual thing, but I felt I would be missing out on something if I did not get on that bus.
Were the Maritimes an awesome place?
Oh, it's beautiful. We had wonderful weather. Luckily, we didn't have a lot of rain. It's just beautiful up there. I highly recommend it.
Okay, so now you brought up the evil question of bad weather. How do these things handle bad weather? How much do you get? What's the worst you've ever seen?
We've not had any problem with weather. I mean, we've been places where we've had rain for several days where you couldn't get outside and do many things, but we've not had any problem in traveling. We've not, you know, driven in snowstorms. We sometimes plan our traveling around the weather. If there's 4 days of heavy rain coming, we might decide to stay where we're at until the sun comes out again. But
we ran into wind one day in Texas, and I think we planned our day around the wind. And if it ever gets real windy, we'll just pull off the road. Luckily, we've never been in a tornado or near a tornado area. We kind of plan our travels.
I was going to say that these things have the reputation of being tornado magnets.
We've lucked out, I guess.
Yeah.
More full-time residential trailer parks as opposed to RVs, I think.
Well, you wouldn't want to be in any of the above in a tornado.
Yeah.
A lot of your parks have shelters and things if there would be bad weather that you could go to, you know, a tornado shelter. A bathhouse built out of concrete or something.
And I do recall being in Nashville, Tennessee, one evening where the owner of the campground came around and knocked on our doors and warned us that there were tornado warnings just in case we did not have our television or our radio on.
So they watch out for you.
They do.
Yeah. I lived in Arizona for a few years, and my recollection of the winter, what passed for bad weather, because I was in the low desert, you know, lovely in the winter because it was in the 50s or 60s just about every day. But what passed for bad weather was wind. It was windy every day. Not gale force winds, but enough that it was uncomfortable. And I guess for driving a high profile vehicle, it's going to be a consideration.
It is. I can't say we've had any problem with that. We've driven on some days that were, you know, moderately windy. There have been a couple times where we've decided not to travel when we knew there was going to be a lot of wind, but it hasn't been a problem for us at all.
Any other things that came as a big surprise, problematically, things that you went, oh my God, I never thought of this?
Well, I think the biggest issue that we didn't anticipate when we bought this RV, this is our first RV we've had for about 10 years now, and the one thing I think we didn't anticipate was the amount of mechanical issues that would show up, the amount of repairs and maintenance and those type of things.
You were warned, weren't you?
Not really.
Really?
No.
Because I know why. Because I was going to say before we began this, and I never said it, you can sugarcoat everything if you want, but you're not going to do anybody any favors if you do. And I think you guys have been pretty straightforward. But if you want to haul out the big guns, feel free. But the folks that were not warning you about that, you know they experienced it. They didn't want to talk you out of it.
Well, we actually didn't know anyone that was into RVing when we bought this. We retired and we researched RVs mostly by just looking at them on RV lots.
Yeah, and they're not going to tell you anything.
No. And we couldn't find exactly what we wanted, so we ended up ordering this new from the factory and decided exactly, you know, which colors we wanted and what options we wanted on it and that type of thing. But
I'm going to say that all the things you were considering, color is the least important, and probably it didn't seem that way at first, but now it probably is.
Well, there's so many things to consider, size, the length, this type, the brand, and as I think we found out in our 10 years of RV ownership, it doesn't matter what brand you have, you have to anticipate there's going to be quite a bit of maintenance and repairs that you're going to have to do. So from the problematic question that you ask, I guess that would be the unexpected thing that we didn't anticipate was, you know, that you are going to have things to fix and repair and maintain, probably more than most people realize.
Anything else hit you that you're, did you get lonely? Do you get, say, I'm tired of being here. If you're tired of being here, you can go somewhere else.
That's true.
Yeah, that's true.
And you've met so many people. If you're a people person, you're going to have friends like every place.
Yes,
and Herb can always get on the radio and talk.
Well, you can too.
Yeah, and I can too.
Do you ever?
Very seldom. No. I have other hobbies. I have a travel blog, so family and friends can keep up with us and see what we've done.
Where is that?
It's on the internet.
Well, yes, of course it's on the internet. What's its name?
Okay, you're right. Every travel blog has a name, and it's quiltergal1.wordpress.com.
Quiltergal1.wordpress.com.
Correct.
Okay. And how often do you update that?
It all depends if I have the time. My latest time I updated it was December, and now it's already February, so I'm really behind.
Yes, you're behind.
Yes,
because I know
am.
People that do it like, well, they start it every day, and then it's every week, but it's not usually much longer than every week.
Right. And I really like to do it that way, but there's just been too many things going on right now, rallies, and Christmas came, and it's departed, and you name it. And I'm, like I said, I'm a quilter. I'm working on a project right now for my youngest daughter, who has a birthday at the end of the month, so that's more important than the travel blog.
So quilting is something you can do right here in the RV. You just, just relax, turn on the TV or whatever.
Right, and I can quilt outside, too, because we have an outlet outside in the motorhome, so I can plug in my sewing machine, which is electric. Some of my things are done by hand, but most of the time I need the sewing machine.
But that's what you get to do, to just pure relax.
Right.
So that's pretty good. Show how determined she is to quilt, Lois was making a quilt.
For Carla.
A quilt for one of her daughters, and there was a time frame on it because her birthday was coming up. And we were in the Everglades National Park in South Florida, in the Everglades, with no electricity, boondock camping, and she made a quilt on generator power.
Right, and then in the Everglades, too, you're limited on the hours you can run that generator.
Because it's noisy, at least somewhat
right,
noisy.
Right, because it's noisy, right. So I had to be planning a little bit ahead when I'm doing my sewing.
She was sitting outside under the awning on the picnic table with her sewing machine and a generator running, quilting in the Everglades.
Ever run into places that's just way too hot, really super uncomfortable?
Once in a while.
And you try to get out of those places.
Yeah,
when
yeah.
You can't completely plan to the day just what the weather's going to be as you're moving in and out.
No, no. So then you stay indoors and stay inside the air-conditioned motorhome.
And most of those days have been actually in the northern states in the summer, which people that live there will tell you it can be 100 degrees, you know, in North Dakota, Minnesota, South Dakota,
yeah,
in July. And that's the hottest weather we've experienced has been in the northern states. We attend the Winnebago Grand National Rally every year in Forest City, Iowa, which is where the factory is. And there's about 1,200 or 1,400 motorhomes park out on a big grass field. And we have electricity and water, but it's in the middle of July.
And it's usually one of the hottest events we attend.
It's typically 90 degrees every day when we're there. I mean, you run your air conditioning when you're inside. And when you're outside, you just put up with the heat.
All right, so the guy over there in the corner of the audience is saying, I thought this was a ham radio show. There's nets and stuff. There's things that gather you folks together on the air activities.
Yes, there is just an amazing number of activities you can be involved in that are both RV and amateur radio related.
And some formal organizations as well behind them.
Yes.
Tell me a little bit about some of those.
We're members. The group that's gathering right here on the fairgrounds that we're parked with right now is called the RV Service Net. And it's a subsidiary of the Airstream organization, but it's not all Airstreamers.
He's in a Winnebago.
Yeah. There's actually the Airstream owners are in the minority in the radio club. They welcome everyone, and we're active in that. That particular group has four or five different nets during the day on different bands in different parts of the country. They have a Rocky Mountain net. They have a West Coast net. They have an East Coast net. They have a 20-meter nationwide net that meets twice a day. We're active in those, and we attend a number of their rallies and get-togethers.
Where do they have rallies?
This is one of them. Probably the biggest one is right here in Orlando every year at the HamCation HamFest.
At the Orlando Fairgrounds.
On the Orlando Fairgrounds. We're also members of the Family Motor Coach, better known as FMCA, Amateur Radio Club. The FMCA is a large RV organization, and they have a subsidiary amateur radio club.
So I was going to ask if the ham radio things are often totally independent, or are they little subsets of big RV groups?
It's both. In the case of the RV Service Net, it's a subset of an Airstream larger club. We're also members of the FMCA, which is a subset club of the larger FMCA. The radio club is called the FMCA Amateur Radio Club, or ARC, and there's a group of them meeting here on the fairgrounds also, and we're friends with most of those people, and we've been participating in some of their events. There are standalone RV / ham clubs. We're also members of one called the RV Radio Network, and that's not associated with any other group. It's just a standalone radio club, and
they have a net every evening.
Yes, they have a 40-meter net that's on.
I guess by definition, they don't have a club meeting every month.
No,
no.
There are no club meetings with any of these, basically.
No, right.
Although some of them are quite organized, and they have a president, vice president, secretary, treasurer. Some are much more loosely organized,
mm-hmm. And probably an online presence of some kind, a website. And
yes, they all have that.
And we belong to the Winnebago WIT Radio Group, and they have officers. And they meet once a year at the big Grand National Rally in Forest City, Iowa. And I'm secretary treasurer of this organization.
I didn't know I was in the presence of celebrity.
You are.
All right. So, and my hamming is more concentrated to the east. So my attention was attracted to all this here at Orlando because it's just obvious. It's enormous. I go to Dayton, but Dayton doesn't have the room for RVs on site. I understand that there's some things that go on in some campgrounds around the Dayton area, but they're not right at the HamFest. Are there other HamFests that are extremely RV friendly, or is this sort of like the mecca of RVing for at least for the east side of the country?
This is the only one I know that has this type of facility where, you know, 100 or 200 RVs can literally park on the HamFest grounds. I don't know of any other that does that.
Somebody was mentioning on 2 meters yesterday, there is, I can't recall if it was Pennsylvania, where they have like a HamFest, not as large as Orlando HamCation, where they gather and they have room for RVs to stay right on the grounds.
Yeah, well, just about any fairgrounds is, and a lot of HamFests do fairgrounds, so
yeah,
they're going to have some room.
Yeah.
But this one seems,
this is
seems
one of
to
the largest.
Yeah, get super serious about
it.
Shelby, North Carolina, has a lot of RVs, but it's still not quite like this. I can't help but notice that Gordon West on Ham Nation talks about Quartzsite almost incessantly around this time of year, which is a couple of weeks ago. Have you ever been to the Quartzsite ham thing?
Yes,
we have.
Yeah, okay. How does that compare? What, it's just a ham radio thing.
It's large. We were there about 3 or 4 years ago. We've been there once, and we camped in the desert. They call it Quartzfest, and it's a group of, I don't remember the number. It was probably a couple hundred.
Oh, at least. I think it was close to 500, believe it or not, when we were there.
That just park out in the desert with no hookups, no electricity.
Yeah, that is boondocking. So
that's really the ultimate boondocking.
Yeah.
Yep. And that's all ham radio, the 400 or 500?
Yes.
That's all
ham radio.
And it's not a part of a bigger event?
No.
No.
Just purely?
Someone
purely
started this years ago, and it just grew and grew into this monstrous event.
Okay, so it's way bigger than what we have here at Orlando.
As far as the
there
number
may be,
of RVs
I don't know what,
go, yes.
Do they have a count of the number of RVs here? Do you know?
I don't know.
Looks like it could be 50 or 60.
On the grounds, I think more than that. I think there's about 25 in our group, maybe.
Oh, there's more though, Herb, because there's some south of us.
Yeah, you know,
they're parked all in different areas. We probably have 25 right here.
Okay, so it could be a
club.
Could be 100 to 200.
Yeah.
I think 100 easily.
But the Quartzfest was overwhelmingly bigger.
Yes. And they have seminars. They set up a special event station that they invite anybody can come and operate.
And they call it Quartzfest.
And you have to listen to Gordon West sing.
I don't know if he was there when
I think
were there.
He did put on a seminar.
Okay.
There are different seminars. We didn't hear him sing, but there is organized activities.
He did
going.
This year. He got a lot of heat for it.
Oh, really? Okay.
But the singing was okay, but putting it on Ham Nation, he got a lot of heat for.
Oh, wow. And then also there's an RV show in town that I think will attract a lot of people.
Yeah. And then there's pure RV events that probably have your little subgroup of hams that cluster together. Do you try to be physically in approximately the same area when you go to a huge RV event?
Very typically, we will camp with a group of people we know. Yeah.
And everybody tries to get on HF and causes massive interference.
Yes, sometimes. The interesting thing at Quartzfest was it seems to have evolved into a contest of who can put up the craziest, biggest antenna. So you'll see things like a 12-foot casita trailer with a beam, full-size beam above it, and it's really interesting.
Yeah, I don't see anybody putting up a huge antenna here, but then they're only here for the weekend.
That's
so
true.
You're going to be limited. If you're going to spend some time someplace, do you end up thinking about putting up a more serious antenna array? Do you just stay with your job?
Yeah, I haven't myself, but we have some friends, particularly one group of full-timing friends that are in an Airstream trailer, and he will put up some extensive wire antennas if he can find trees that he can shoot wires up into, and he has quite good luck with that.
Anybody do any of that towing a tower on a trailer thing?
I've not seen that.
No, we have not seen that.
So there's a limit to how crazy you people go.
Yes.
Yeah. How well does your antenna array work? I'm pretty happy with Tar Heel antenna on my car, but you know, I get that constant signal report. Oh, you got a great signal for a mobile. You always have to say that.
Yeah. It's, you know, it's more of a challenge. You've got to keep in mind that you're using an antenna that's maybe 15 feet off the ground, and it's short compared to anything you'd put in your backyard if you owned a home. So, you know, given that, they work amazingly well.
I'm guessing you bust your share of pileups.
I don't know that I would say I can do that, but I have no trouble working DX stations.
Have you worked in Navassa yet?
No, I haven't.
Have you tried much?
No, I've not tried at all. I don't chase DX, but if I turn the radio on and I hear DX stations on calling CQ, I will answer them and they will usually come back to me. I typically spend, some of it is involved with nets and that type of thing, but I typically spend an hour or two every day on the radio when we're parked someplace. And it's not uncommon to work a DX station. Depends a little bit where you are in the country. Like here in Florida, you can get on and work Europeans as easy as you can work the U.S.
So the 5 years you've been full-timing, you have crossed a sunspot peak.
Yes.
And now, and theoretically, we're heading into the doldrums. Although, what's happened with this sunspot cycle that was supposed to be going away? It seems to be surging over the since last summer.
It's interesting. When the peak was supposed to be here, it wasn't. And now that it's supposed to be over, it's actually very good.
Yeah, my experience, and I don't get on the air as much as I'd like, but it's just been awesome.
Yeah, 10, 12, 15 meters are open almost every day lately.
Yeah. Not the all-night thing that the super sunspot peaks have had that, you know, are legendary, but just being open every day is pretty cool. So you're having a good time.
Yes.
And getting an hour or two a day of hamming is pretty amazing.
Mm-hmm. And then how about another hour of talking to friends that are on the road? Some are in Ohio, one's in Arizona right now, one's in Louisiana, and they meet at a certain time of the day in the morning, either on 40 or 20. It just depends on how well the bands are during the day.
So it's not all nets, just a lot of ad hoc.
Yeah, there's a group of friends that I get on with almost every morning. We do it 6 days a week, and most are RVers, so they're moving around, so you're all moving targets. So
four of them are here right today.
Yes.
On the Orlando Fairgrounds.
And so depending on if it's summer or winter or whatever, where these people are, we use different bands. We alternate between 40 and 20, and sometimes we use both bands on a particular day, switching back and forth. And usually everyone can end up talking to everyone. And one station might be in Louisiana, one might be in Mesa, Arizona, two might be in Florida, one might be, you know, someplace else. One might be at home in Dayton, Ohio, or whatever. But we'll all get on, and usually everyone can hear everyone. It's amazing.
And once again, this is just about everybody's sitting still.
Yes.
For some reason, I have the idea in mind that because this is motorhome, it's moving all the time, and it's not. It's sitting still most of the time.
It is.
Yes.
I'll try to reconcile myself to that idea. We're getting down to the part of the interview where I start running out of questions, but you may have information that I haven't asked you about. What is there about this lifestyle that people don't understand?
Well, the two things that I didn't anticipate when we started full-time RVing and RVing in general, and even more so when we went full-time, because we've done both part-time and full-time, the one I already mentioned was that I was surprised about how much maintenance and repairs and upkeep and things that there are.
So be prepared for that.
On an RV, that exceeded anything I anticipated. Which
now,
was
have you had a breakdown on the road that disabled you in a really inconvenient place?
No flat
we've not had anything major.
Knock on Formica.
But
here's some wood.
Yeah.
Right.
That's the negative that I didn't anticipate. The positive I didn't anticipate is the social contact part of it, the friends we've made,
the
wonderful clubs that we've joined, the people that not only are temporary friends, but they're permanent friends that, I mean, we maybe have met 5, 6, 7 years ago that we talk to every day, that we meet 4 or 5 times a year. Many of them are full-timers, and by pure coincidence, our paths cross. We may meet them in Portland, Oregon in the fall. We may meet them in Dayton, Ohio at the HamFest in May, and we meet them down here in Florida at Orlando in February. So the friends that we've made, the good friends that we've made and kept, we didn't anticipate.
People in the RV community in general have that. People in the ham radio aspect probably have it in spades.
Yes, that's true.
Well, everybody can communicate on the internet. Hams have been professional communicators
That's true. You can do it on the internet and you can do it on the cell phone, but you meet people. You're not going to call in a group of five of them and get together and talk every morning on your cell phones.
Yeah.
You just don't do it because it's...
Well, there's chat rooms and things. So
you can do that. I think hams do it more, though, because of the challenge. It's like, can we all get on?
We've got our magic of radio.
And how does your... What's your signal report today? And you have an excuse to get on because there's the challenge of trying to communicate. We went to Alaska 4 years ago and spent most of the summer up there. And the challenge was to get on with the same groups that I talk to every day down here in the lower 48, was to get involved in that group from up there. And, of course, the success was not quite as good, but it was there. We did it. And
they're probably eager to try to talk to you.
So you communicate with these people. A lot of it is because of the fun of doing it.
Yeah. Well, we're the ultimate McLuhan. You know, the message is the medium. It's being able to do it. What you put into that, sometimes it's worthwhile stuff, and sometimes it's just cocktail conversation, just drivel.
Yes.
We're professionals that just babbling on. Guy in the audience over there, he's saying, yes, you're a professional at babbling on. Do that all the time. So we talked about some of the infrastructure in terms of water and power and stuff, but I forgot to ask about the new infrastructure, communications, internet, television. What do you do for that?
Okay, we use Verizon as our internet. We have a cell phone through Verizon. You pay a certain amount of money for that. And then for our internet service, we buy 10 gigabytes, and that's about $80 a month. Not cheap, but we also need the internet. And luckily with Verizon, we are pretty much able to get it everywhere on the road except in the mountains. Wherever, if you're close to an interstate, and the cell towers are moving now to smaller cities too, so you can get your signal. So we rely a lot on the internet, emailing a lot of our friends. Also, that's how I get on to my travel blog and develop that. What else?
And if the internet doesn't work, like if we're in the middle of nowhere in Alaska, I can rely on amateur radio, and I can email through what's called Winlink, and I'm sure a lot of hams are familiar with that. And it's HF, basically HF email, and you can access 24/7 any place in the world. You can be at the South Pole, and you can send an email to somebody.
Do a lot of ham RVers do that?
It's not real popular. It's as all modes, you have to have your own type of equipment and know-how and figure out how to do it and software. But
that's a computer, an interface, modem. And for really good fast Winlink, you need an expensive modem, right? Do you use Winmore, the software version?
I use the SCS modem.
So you bought the expensive one,
which is made in Germany. And
about $1,000.
Well, if you want to buy a new one, but there are a lot of them available that are used out there for half of that price, and they're built to last forever. So if you want to get into that, you don't have to spend $1,000 to get into it. You can get into it spending a lot less than that. I like to keep active in that in the event that I ever have the opportunity to help with some emergency communications, because it is a fabulous emergency communication systems. Hurricane Katrina, there were tens of thousands of messages passed in and out of Louisiana with amateurs using Winlink when there was no other communications available. The phones, internet, everything else was down.
Now it's high speed within its context.
Yes.
Within the broader context of the data communications, it's very, very low speed.
Yes.
But it's good to get short email messages.
It's an email system, but
I'm not going to send a JPEG picture along
you,
with it.
You can send attachments.
Little attachments.
Yeah, you can send small attachments. I haven't used it for that. It's primarily for email. But a long, long email message will easily go through in 20 seconds. So you can send a lot of messages in an hour if you wanted to, especially under an emergency situation.
Okay. I think people may be familiar with, aware of it, but not really familiar with very much about it.
You mentioned television, too. We don't watch a lot of television. We rely just on the channels that are wherever we are locally. We do not have a satellite dish, so we just use the outside antenna on the roof of the motorhome.
Yeah. But a lot of people will get one of the satellite services, and I understand that they tend to, they have a way to accommodate people doing the full-time RV lifestyle.
Yes, a lot of people love to watch television, and they can bring their local channels with them from the previous state wherever they lived, if they're full-timers or if they still have a house, you know, they bring that with them.
Yeah, little satellite dish on a tripod outside, as long as you can see the southern, southwestern sky usually.
Or on the roof of the RV if you're out in the open.
So you, but you just watch whatever local TV you can get when you're enough someplace.
We're not big television watchers.
And not big YouTube watchers either with a limited data plan like that.
Right.
See, no one in the community that we're doing a program about is going to watch it because nobody can pull down the data. Well, the good news is they have an audio stream, and that'll be about 30 megabytes, so you can listen, but you won't be able to see these guys.
Yes.
All right, I think that probably about wraps it up. I'm going to go take some pictures out there of the things that we've talked about that I haven't done already. I've wandered around a little bit.
One more comment I want to make. When we pull into a gas station, a lot of people will ask, how can we afford this, filling up our tank with fuel? And I know the price of gasoline, we have a gasoline motorhome, it's cheap right now. But think of this. We always tell them, we have our bedroom with us, we have our kitchen with us, and we have our bathroom. So if you stay at a nice motel like a Holiday Inn, it's going to run you $125 to $150 a night.
Which is your gas tank.
Which is our gas tank, usually. Sometimes I think it's been close to $250. You got to watch it. When you're in Canada, it's more dollars.
Yeah. Well, what does it cost to stay in a campground for a night or an extended stay?
Yeah, believe it or not, I have a spreadsheet on all the campgrounds we've ever stayed at, and it's averaging for us $20 a night. Some of them could be $10 a night with electricity and water, and others can be up to $45. I think that's been the most expensive.
And if you do an extended stay someplace.
If you stay by the month, it's cheaper.
Yeah. Do the campgrounds provide Wi-Fi?
Some of them do, very few. But yeah, that's another way to get onto the YouTubes.
Yeah, but if they don't have it, or if it's not good.
Yeah.
You need your own regardless.
Right. You need your own, or you can always go to a public library or a coffee shop.
Always a way.
There's always a way.
From a cost standpoint, you learn as you travel to find nice places to stay that are inexpensive. And we've found things that we didn't even realize existed, like Lois mentioned before, the Army Corps of Engineer parks, which if you're over 62, you get a 50% discount. So you're staying on the shore of a beautiful lake with a campground that's as big as some people's yards with trees around you for $15 a night, in some cases with full hookups.
So you look for the bargains.
And a commercial campground would charge double or triple that for the same. We do city parks, county parks, national parks, Army Corps of Engineer. That's not all we do, but it really makes the economics make sense when you can start finding places like that.
I have thought of one more question, maybe the most uncomfortable one, and good for the end of the show, an exit strategy. At some point, everybody, as somebody was describing last night in the group, my best idea is to just not wake up one morning. You know, and of course, if that happens to one of you, that leaves the other one of you, and that's not going to be any fun. But do people think about when you're doing this, how you're eventually not going to be doing it anymore?
Some people do. I have to tell you too. When we started full timing, Herb has a brother that keeps on asking, "When are we going to start looking for a real house?" And he finally figured it out that we are not looking. But it's going to, I think it'll depend on health. We plan to go as long as we both are still healthy.
And healthcare on the road may be just another issue. You know, it's not the exit strategy yet, but what do you do when something goes wrong? I mean, there's hospitals and stuff.
Well, a lot of people say I could never full-time because if I got sick or I got hurt or fell down and broke my leg, I couldn't go to my doctor. Well, in most cases, when you fall down and broke your leg, you don't go to your doctor anyway. You go to the emergency room and you take whatever doctor's there. Well, that's basically what we would do. So,
or urgent care.
We do go open. We do have a regular doctor that we go to once a year, that we go back to. We usually spend some time in South Dakota, a couple weeks every summer, and we have a doctor and a dentist there, and we go for our annual physicals and checkups. But other than that, you know, you seek health care, you know, where you're at, and we've been fortunate. We've been quite healthy. If you had a lot of health issues, it would make full-timing more difficult, but we know people that full-time that do have health issues, so if you're determined, it is amazing what some people do, and, you know, I give them a lot of credit for doing that, but we've been lucky from that standpoint. So other than a, you know, a finger infection in your finger or some minor thing you can go to a emergency room with, we've been quite lucky.
Yeah. Americans in general are not very good at end-of-life decisions and planning and things like that. So it comes as no surprise that RVers are probably in the same category. Although, and you said that there are some young ones that you have met, but probably most are in the ham radio demographic.
Yes, and, you know, and retired.
Yeah.
Retired in the, you know, 60s, early retirees, maybe in the 50s, then 60s, 70s.
Yes.
Do you see many 80s and 90s? Are people still able to do that up into that zone?
Yes, we have a friend that he RV'd, not full-time, but he RV'd probably 7 months a year until he was 96.
Right.
So it is.
And towing a car.
And towing an RV the same size as ours and same brand as ours, towing a car.
And a ham radio operator. And talking.
Talking, going down the highway up to age 96. Yeah. And he's still very active on the bands, but not in his RV anymore. So it really depends on your health and your physical condition.
And your individual likes and dislikes. So it's an individual thing.
Well, the RV itself is a pretty substantial asset if you've maintained it well. So when it's time to do something, you're selling that is a pretty big piece of cash.
That's true. And a lot of people that full-time, well, at some point, maybe because of age or health reasons or because they just want to settle down someplace, sometimes they will buy a lot someplace and they will park an RV on it and stay there. Some will buy a townhouse or a condominium someplace and keep their RV to still do some limited travel. Some will sell the RV completely and get out of it. It just depends on your individual wants, yeah, needs, and circumstances.
Now, they don't depreciate like property does. It's going to depreciate,
yeah,
from the original purchase price.
That's the thing people don't anticipate. They think that the cost is the fuel. The largest cost in an RV is the depreciation by far. It will far exceed your fuel cost.
Okay, but when it's time to go out of it, you still have pretty valuable asset to sell.
Yes, yes.
And retirement home or whatever the next stage is going to be.
Yeah. We have no exit strategy. we'll come up with one when we need it.
Yeah, that's right. Keep our fingers crossed.
There's too many unknowns to say, you know, in 6 years we're going to do this or we're going to do that in 4 years.
And we haven't figured out what state we want to finally reside in either, if we're both still alive.
But you've been everywhere, like that song, I've been everywhere, man. You have been everywhere. You got a chance to sample the whole country. Where do you like best?
Florida.
But you don't spend the winter here, or the summer, rather.
Right, no. Yeah, I don't know. So,
yeah.
It would be...
Go into the bathroom, turn the shower on, as hot as it'll go,
yeah,
and then spend an hour there like that.
Then
you get an idea.
Yeah.
It would probably be in a southern state. We spent most of our life in the northern part of the country, and we would probably be somewhere in the southern part of the U.S., at least the southern half.
You got more research to do.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. All right. Thank you very much. I appreciate that you're talking to me. You can say goodbye to everyone. Look right in the camera and say,
bye.
See you on the road.
Yeah, see you on the road.
See you later.
And thanks, Gary. It's been interesting.
Thanks, guys. As usual with Ham Radio Now, if you enjoy the programs, Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. So I left Arvin back at the studio back in North Carolina, so his nose is out of joint. But even so, he'll still collect your money. So stop by hamradionow.tv, click on Arvin's little icon, and help us out if you can, if you enjoy the programs, whatever they're worth to you. That's it for this episode of Ham Radio Now from the Orlando HamCation. In the RV zone, I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ 73, over. And I'm going back to Raleigh.